देवकी परमानंदम कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं भीष्मद्रोणतटाजयध्रुतजला गान्धारनीलोत्पला शल्यग्राहवतीकृपेण वहनी कर्णेन वेलाकुला अश्वत्थामविकर्णघोरमुखरा दुर्योधनावर्तिनी उत्तीर्णा खलु पाण्डवैरनदी कैवर्ततः केशवः वाराशर्यवचत्सरोजममलं गीतार्थगन्धोत्कटम् नानाख्यानकृतेसरं तथा सम्बोधनाबोधितं लोके सज्जनषट्पदैरहरः ते पीयमानं मुदा भूयात् भारतपुङ्गजं परिमलध्वं सुनश्रेयसे मुखं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुं लङ्घयते गिरं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे परमानन्दमाधवम् यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतस्तुम्बन्ति दिव्यैः सवैः वेदैः शान्तपदस्तमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं शान्ताः ध्यानावस्थितस्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनो यस्यां तन्न विदुस्तुदाधना देवाय तस्मै नमः ॐ नमो भगवते
Thank you, Shyamji. Wonderful, Shyam. We could get started. Are you all able to see my screen?
Okay. A little bigger, maybe. Yes. Is it if possible?
Okay.
Or give us time to find it in our book.
Yes, yes, yes. Is that? Oh yeah. This is the max I'm able to do. But yeah, when it's chapter number 2, verse 47 and 48. This is a very popular loka that we have all heard multiple times. So we could meditate on this. We can begin with this. Okay. कर्मण्येवाधिकारस्ते मा फलेषु कदाचन मा कर्म फलहेतु मा ते कर्मणि we can read the English translation. You have the right to work, but never to its fruit. Let not the fruits of action be your motive, nor let your attachment be the cause of inaction. What we could do is we could take turns in reading the sloka, if that is okay, the meaning, English meaning. That way everybody can participate. Let's go to
I'm a bit confused. You already read the meaning, so do you want us everybody to read the same thing?
Yeah, I guess if you have another interpretation of that sloka, you can
yeah, I think that would be better.
Yes.
No point reading the same thing, everyone.
Yes, yes. If there is anything else that you want to add,
have another book, I can read that.
Yes, go sure. Ahead.
You have a right to perform your prescribed duty, but you are not entitled to the fruits of action. Never consider yourself the cause of the results of your activities, and never be attached to not doing your duty.
Um, you know, on that point, you know, something that I always wanted to see is, what is renunciation of food? Does it mean you don't care about, you go unplanned? That is some of the misconception that some people might have. To address that, I have written here, with regard to every action, one must know the result that is expected to follow, the means hitherto, and the capacity for it. We should plan, but after having planned, being thus equipped, without any desire for the result, we need to wholly engross ourselves, give fulfillment. That is said to be renouncing the fruits of action. Any other thoughts on that? Please feel free to add.
Yeah, I have a little portion that I would like to read here.
Please.
Desire-tainted karma gives continuity to the wheel of birth and death. The seekers after heavenly enjoyments are also slaves to desire. Conquerors of desire are they who care not for the fruits of karma. Freedom from desire is the real freedom. When duty is discharged, untarnished by desire, clarity of understanding ensues. In addition to it, efficiency increases. Karma therefore has to be performed perfectly by the aspirant, unmindful of the fruits thereof. So there is a small quote by Sri Ramakrishna. A boat may be floating on water, but no water should be allowed to get into it. Man may live in the world, but no worldly desire ought to take possession of him. So we should be like the boat on the water.
Okay. Not like. And the other example they talk about is the lotus leaves. Yeah,
that is very
common. Yeah, where water just goes over it. Right. Anything else to add? Please feel free. Not, we can go to the next sloka in the same chapter 48, the very following sloka.
Yeah, actually, probably we can spend a little more time on that one, couple of minutes.
Okay.
What I mean to say, what karmas we do, why do we do karmas, we have to understand. I didn't understand all the, the readings, because it was the words are very, my vocabulary is very limited. But we have to understand why we are doing what we are doing, the karma, what kind of karmas we do, right? See, past karmas, our past karmas present situations to us. The action that we take, that is going to give the karma phalas again, right? That's right. The action, we have the, right to do the actions only. But karma phala pradata is Lord. That's what sloka says, right? For example, I desired some house and I keep on working, but there is no guarantee that I accumulate enough money to get a house, okay? But when you request a God, the God has to, he said, God all promises always, whatever you desire, I will give you. But it doesn't have to be in this world. That's why he says, Ma karma phala hetur bhuhu. Don't become the reason to that karma phalas. That means if you desire something and you wish something, you do the karma, God has to give that karma, but that doesn't have to be this life or in the future life. That is leading to our, birth and death, the cycle we are falling into, right? That's what, becoming the karma phala hetu. Okay, but when people think that see, I don't have the right to I have the right to do the karmas, but not but the karma phalas. Why do I need to do the karmas? That's why Lord is saying, don't become interested in not doing the karmas. You have to do the karmas because that is your duty. Because without karmas, you cannot live. Actually, even the thought is also a karma. The watch, speech is also karma. It can be. And our actions are bodily actions. All the karmas can be done in many ways. But when people think that they are not interested, they are not getting the karma phalas they want, they may lose the interest in doing the karmas. But that's what Lord is saying. Don't be like that. You have to do your karmas, okay? But in a prescribed way, that that we won't be bonding, you know, binding, you know, like, you know, they won't become bondages. That's what I think, you know. Over, I don't know, it's my, I don't know, I may be confusing all, but.
Wonderful, Srinivas. I think well said. So, yeah, I guess don't think you are the cause of it. Like Hetuhu, we have also split up the meaning of it. Word by word, don't become the cause of it.
Yeah.
Don't get attached to it.
Yes.
Thank you, Srinivas. We could move on to the 48th verse, which is the very next verse. What is the technique to do it?
I think it was easier if one person chants. Otherwise, okay. It's getting a little confusing to hear everyone together.
Okay.
So, okay. Whoever, Shanti, would you like to?
Okay.
Yes.
Yoga sat guru karmani sandham jatva dhananjaya yasya siddhyo samo bhutva samatvam yoga uchyate. Being steadfast in yoga, O Dhananjaya, perform actions, abandoning attachment, remaining unconcerned as regards success and failure. This evenness of mind in regard to success and failure is known as yoga.
In such equanimity is called yoga. Here, yoga comes over and over in Bhagavad Gita. It's a technique of attaining supreme knowledge or wisdom. Different types of yogas are there. There are about 82 types of yogas, they say. But the major ones we talk about in Gita. I guess any other translation anybody else wants to add? To what Shyamji has just said?
Not in terms of translation, but again, Sri Ramakrishna's small explanation. So he says, be in the world even as a maid servant in a rich man's house. For all intents and purposes, she claims her master's children and property as her own. But she has no attachment to them. She can easily relinquish her assumed ownership of the master's property. Same way, be prepared for separation from earthly possessions. I thought that is a very practical example.
Yeah, wonderful.
Deepak, I think my book also say the same. So, but I have a question about yoga. Can you explain a little more about the definition of yoga you mentioned? I think it's very interesting.
Yeah, I guess I request others also to chip in. What my understanding is, it's a path. It's a technique for attaining Brahma Vidya or attaining knowledge or the supreme wisdom. Like how Dhyana Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, different paths. Srinivas, I know you have mentioned, we have talked about yoga, right?
Go ahead. I think yoga has a different meanings in different places, actually. For example, but eventually everything is, aligns as you go to the top. For example, Patanjali says, Chitta Vritti Nirodha Yoga. That means our Chitta means our kind of subconscious mind is always inspiring because of the gunas to do the actions. Okay? And because of that impurity that we have, that vasanas and impurities that is coming from janmas, you know, like several lives. Okay? That has to be arrested, that has to be subsided in order to get the jnana, like, you know, and second, actual Sanskrit meaning in yoga means union. Okay, union means, you know, like, you know, jivatma uniting with Paramatma is yoga. That means, you know, the process of obtaining the Paramatma is the yoga. As you mentioned, it's a marga, it's a path. But again, Lord himself, he says in Bhagavad Gita, here in this one, it is Samatvam Yoga Uchyate. And also he says, Karmasu Kaushalam Yoga, he says in the previous one of the slokas. That means, what he is defining is the Karma Yoga is, see, we do the karmas in all the time, we just mentioned, right? With mental, with thought, with the speech and with actions, we do all the time karmas. But the skillfully not getting attached to the karma phalas is also yoga. That is karma yoga. That is saying, he mentions many, many places. Yoga means also aprapya vastu praptihi yoga. That's also says. That means the one you don't have obtaining, that is also yoga. That's why it's used in many, many different meanings, different ways, different places. You have to take in the context where it is used. In the Lord, when he's saying in this session, I think he's saying about the karma yoga. You know, yogastakur karmani sangam tetva dhananjaya siddhya siddhyo samo bhutva samatvam yogichade. All these characteristics are karma yoga, because you have to do the yoga in staying in the yoga in the karma yoga. That means remembering the principles, because it's very easy to fall off the path, because unless we are not very careful. Think about all the time that you are doing the karma just for the, you know, like principles of the karma yoga, why you are doing the karma. That's why yogastha kuru karmani, that means stay in the yoga. Remember always the principles of the karma yoga. And what are those? Simply saying sangam tyaktva. Sangam means it has two meanings. One, sangam is, you know, interest, your asakti. Okay, that is one. And also sangam is also attachment. You have to renounce your attachment to the karma you are doing. You have to renounce your interest in doing the karmas, that one. And also, siddhya siddhyo samo bhutva. Siddhi means accomplishment. It's higher than accomplishment, actually. Asiddhi means non-accomplishment, failure. Okay? Maybe not having both of them taking equally, whether it is siddhi is a success or accomplished, failure or success, both of them you have to take equally. That is what samatvam, labhanashta, you know, like praise and also insult. These kind of, you have both, it's a dvandas, right? Those dvandas, if you take the samatvam, take equally, when you do the karma, you don't have the karma phala's interest, because you don't have the interest in the karma phala. That is what it says. That's one of the ways of saying yoga. That's also samatvam yoga, which is Lord Krishna says in this sloka. Yoga has different meanings. Does it make it clear, or did I confuse you all?
It was clear.
I think essentially in this particular sloka, samatva.
Yeah. Yes.
Samatva is the most important aspect here. Because whether you are you perform a karma, there is success or failure, you should look at it, you know, with equanimity, with samatva. So I think that's what the essence of this particular sloka is. There are a number of yogas that are described in Gita in different places. But in this particular shloka, it is samatva is most important aspect, as I see it.
That's correct. Yeah.
Thank you, Shyamji.
I'd like to add one more thought.
Yes.
So as Srinivas said, yoga has multiple meanings. So in case of, I just want to put 2 points. So in case of chapter name or adhyaya name, it is like it is to be taken as a episode, right? Karma episode, jnana episode, whatever, bhakti yog, bhakti episode. So the meaning really is or changes actually, and that is one. And one more thought about this two shlokas is basically what we are gaining from this is a knowledge. Right? Knowledge of what? The knowledge of the structure already placed by Lord. That is, you can do only karma and the fall is really not in your hands, or even after you complete your karma, you have to leave it. Right? In, for example, you make idli or any dish, right? Any dosa, for example. Once that is done, it is to be arpan karna chahiye, right? Then the customer or your family will decide how the test is. It's not in your control once it is done. So only up to I do idli, it's under my control. Then it's done. Thank you.
Thank you, Abhay. Thank you all for the good interpretation. So I guess we can move to the next one again. Siddhi, Asiddhi, like the dualities, I think Dvandvas that Srinivas talked about, I wanted to say all dualities, you know, not just success, failure, all dualities, equanimity, Samatvam for handling all dualities is the focus. All right, thank you. We'll move on to the next one. This again from the same chapter. Who would want to go? This is a very, very nice sloka. Everybody can relate to it. Yeah, would you like to, or Srinivas?
And then my tune is very bad.
I can do keeper.
Okay. Chapter 263.
Krodhad bhavati sammoha, sammoha smriti vibhramaha, smritim bhram shuddhi. शुद्धि विनाशो बुद्धि नाशात प्रणश्यति. From anger proceeds delusion, from delusion confused memory, from confused memory the ruin of reason, due to the ruin of reason he perishes.
I would like to add one thing. Actually, this is not sloka by alone itself. It has to be taken from the previous sloka also, because it's not sloka by itself. Two slokas together makes big me actual sense.
I see what you're saying.
62, say, you have to do the 62, then 63, because it says, Jayato Vishayan Pumsaha Sangaste Shupajayate Sangas Sanjayate Kamaha Kamatro Dobhijayate. I have Telugu, will someone read please English version?
Brooding on the objects of senses, man develops attachment to them. From attachment comes desire, from desire, anger sprouts forth. And then the next one, from anger proceeds delusion, from delusion, confused memory, from confused memory, the ruin of reason. Due to the ruin of reason, he perishes. Thank you, Srinivas. That is.
Thank you. Thank you, Srinivas Vidya. So the meaning is the attachment, the root cause of any negative behavior, when a thing or an event doesn't happen in a way that you want it, it causes anger. So I guess verse number 62 brings in the attachment and what attachment leads to the negative behavior. And that is the context with which we need to read this. Is that what you wanted to say, Srinivas?
Yes, actually it starts with dhyayam means it, like, you know, thinking about the thinking, just a simple thoughts, thought level. It starts from the thought level. Anything that you think, you know, for example, I want a house, I want simple things, you know, like, you know, not I want, just think about the house. The house is like this, you know, like, you know, it has the windows, it has nice, it has place, you know, like, if you think about this one, then it makes you attachment, then that leads to the attachment, leads to the desire. At one point you think, oh, I want that kind of house. I'm just giving an example. That means, you know, where it starts, you know, anything from the thought, it starts, thought level. That, you know, once we can control where the, if we show the thought towards a God, think about the God, that will lead to the God, you know, like, you know, for example, the opposite, anything that a worldly materialistic thought, anything that you think, that will lead to this fall down. That's what it says. From thought level to, it leads to the attachment. From attachment, it leads to the desire. Desire, when desire is not fulfilled, we get anger. This is krodha. Krodha means, you know, like, you know, furious, little bit anger on the higher side, actually. Okay. From that anger, delusion, the obsessive thinking about that one. And from that, you know, like, you're losing your mind, actually, who we are, what we are, what is the relation, what that kind of action we are doing, is it appropriate, not appropriate, all this is the buddhi also. Next we'll lose. Once we lose the buddhi, this is a fall down for the any person. Just, you know, that's a simple, you know, not giving a many explanation, but you already read the other one, right?
I have a another one. I have the book from Sri Ramakrishna Mission. So yeah. Each verse has got a short little story or parable that that explains the process or the concept of the shloka. So this one has a nice little story that a prostitute and a holy man, they were living in a street. So the holy man is always telling her that, oh, what you're doing is wrong. This is going to lead you to your afterlife is going to be really bad. Don't do this and all. The woman is extremely in anguish, but every night she is like praying for her forgiveness, that this is the way she has to do it, and then there's no other way that she can make a living. But she asks for forgiveness every day. So they both end up dying on the same day. So of course her body is, you know, disposed of in a very unceremonious way. His body is, they have done a great job of funeral rites and everything. Mm-hmm. But in the afterlife, she ends up in Vaikuntha and he ends up in a Yamaloka and not in a great place. So he's asking, why this injustice? I have been a holy man all my life. Why am I in this place? So the reply comes that even though you were, while on earth, you were doing all the puja, but your mind was thinking what she was doing. Whereas she was doing the wrong things, but every night she was doing it without attachment. She was just doing it to make a living and then moved on. She wasn't dwelling on the pleasures of it or anything like that. So that is the reason why she ends up in Vaikuntha. And on top of that, she was repenting or asking for forgiveness of what was happening. So that is the reason why she is in Vaikuntha and you are not. So I guess that's another one for the detachment.
Wonderful. Good. Very good example, Vijaya. Yeah. I guess that nirmohatvam without attachment is the focus here. And again, I really like how Krishna talks about the sequence, you know, how it bewilders your memory. Like a very good example that we can talk about is a pond. When it is clouded, when it is lot of ruffleness is there, it clouds your memory. In a similar way, whenever anger clouds your memory and you need to settle it down, just like how you can, when the water settles, when everything the settles, you are able to see things clearly. Same way, anger needs to be, we need to overcome anger. And what leads to anger is attachment. And we need to not attach ourselves to any particular action or result. I guess that's very well said by the sloka.
Srinivasji mentioned that it starts with the thinking. So I had that question, like how your thinking start, you know, why you think of a house or think of material thing. But then he answers that, you know, we have to engage our thinking in the God, you know, thinking about God, service to the Lord. So that avoid thinking which lead us to the material sides. Yeah, I like that part. Thank you.
So next sloka, we'll talk about why we are thinking like that. That is next sloka. If we can move on. Comments? Yeah. You. Okay. The next sloka is going to be chapter 2, verse number 5. Whenever you are ready. Chapter 3, verse number 5, there are several slokas that talk about gunas. This is one of them. Why people think the way they think. Srinivas, would you like to go, or Abhay, or Gagan? Not, I can. Okay, Srinivas, I know you are not able to see it, you are saying, right? Anybody else?
Yeah, I can read.
Okay.
Nachit kshanamapi jatu tisthatya karma kruta karyate yavashah karma sarva prakruti jair gunaihi. So, meaning, right?
Yeah.
there is no one who can remain without action, even for a moment. Indeed, all beings are compelled to act by their qualities, born of material nature. The three gunas.
The three gunas, the intrinsic tendencies, is what I was.
Thank you,
Abhay.
Thanks.
My notes is like the sloka says: renouncing from action is not possible. We are all helpless, but to act. How we act is basically based on constitution of three gunas in us. He tells the three gunas are basically the sattvic, rajasic, and tamasic. The combination of three, every person has different configurations of these gunas, and it is these gunas, these intrinsic tendencies to the vasanas, they express themselves, and that those are the things that make you think, and those are the tendencies that make you work, and performing action is inevitable. Yeah, same sloka is also said in Srimad Bhagavatam, exact same phrases. And that is another thing, if you are reading Bhagavatam, in this sloka also. I will stop there for others to comment on it.
Okay, I have same another one of those little short explanation. Those who are enlisted as indoor patients in a hospital cannot get out of it until they are cured. After the cure is effected, they have no need to be in the hospital. Similarly, beings that suffer from the ailment of ignorance are hospitalized in Prakriti. They are being effectively treated with karma for enlightenment. With the dawn of Brahma Jnanam, they quit Prakriti and get to actionlessness.
Wonderful. Yeah. Thank you.
One of Swami Dhyanand Saraswati's long explanation, I won't read all of it, but the gist of it was the three gunas, they pretty much determine how your life is, right? None of us have only one kind. We all have all three, which manifest at different times. But let's say your predominant guna is rajas combined with sattva, then you tend to do good things, but in an aggressive manner. You don't just sit there and do puja. You do puja while getting other people involved and, you know, going after doing the temple and this and that. So that is a higher proportion of rajas with the sattva guna. But a more, if there is a sattva that is more predominant, that person is likely to sit and meditate and read on their own, and you know they do a lot more in seclusion. And at the same time, if there is, you still have the rajas equal proportion, let's say, but also the tamasic guna, then you do it with a lot more. You have the aggression. But at the same time, you tend to kind of do things in a way that is, you know, not necessarily agreeable to everyone. That those kind of things happen too. So every action that we do is at that moment, which guna is taking, you know, upper hand within us. So, and as seekers, our goal is to kind of keep on toning it down and trying to maintain that one that develops detachment all the time. So going back to the previous verse, so that was the gist of Swamiji's. I don't know, Veenaji, if you remember us reading that shloka, but it was a very powerful explanation there. Okay.
Thank you, Jia. That was very good. I guess, you know, that is one thing, you know, I also feel if a person is 100% sattvic, they won't be in this world. They would be one with God. So there is always some constitution of other gunas. And when rajasic is good, but rajasic can drive a person to go in sattvic path or they can go down in the tamasic path. But if they are in tamasic, you are clouded with ignorance, you are in this cycle, you know, in the cycle of not able to come out of it. So you have to move on from one stage to the other, and how different paths are going to help them to move from tamasic to rajasic to sattvic. You would, in the Bhagavad Gita discusses a lot how different people act when they are in sattvic, when they are in rajasic, when they are in tamasic, how different paths are conducive for different mindsets. So that is something you could explore in several slokas. With that thought, I want to open it up for the others to speak. We can move on to the next sloka. Chapter 4, verse number 24. This is Jnana Yoga, and we have heard this sloka multiple times. This is a very popular one. Anybody wants to go? Vasu, Srinivas, okay. I see you guys there, Asha. Anyone wants to try? All right.
Then what are you going? Otherwise, I will go.
Go ahead, Srinivas. Please go.
What I'm seeing here, Shraddhavan Labhate Jnanam.
No. Brahmarpanam.
Okay. Brahmarpanam Brahma Havihi Brahmagno Brahmana Hutam Brahmai Vatena Gantavyam Brahmakarma Samadhinaha. For those who are completely absorbed in the oblation is Brahman. The ladle with which it is offered is Brahman. The act of offering is Brahman. And the sacrificial fire is also Brahman. Such persons who view everything as God exactly attain him easily and attain him. Yeah. So it's a very famous shlokam. Of course, I chant this every time while eating. I think this is one of the shlokas you have to do this. Somebody chant this before and somebody after having the meal. It's basically it is saying the who is doing. That is also everything is an act of yajna, right? So the thing that is being offered, that is taken, or the person who is doing it, everything is Brahman. So with that concept, any act should be done. So yajna is, when you are doing any act, that becomes a yajna at that moment. So that any act should be done with that sense. Yeah, so anybody can interpret that.
Thank you, Srinivas. I guess sacrifice, yajna, you bring a very good point. And you know, everything that we do, the object of the sacrifice, the person making the sacrifice, the instruments with which they make the sacrificial fire itself, thing, you know, are all are nothing different from God. One thing.
So the example is given as a physical doing yajna, but basically philosophically you can interpret that as any act is actually yajna.
Any comments on the word yajna or the
Not in Yajna itself, but here there is a nice little couple of sentences in the translation. Okay. Consuming the daily food regularly is obligatory on all, including the enlightened. But the latter convert eating itself into Jnana Yajna. The food, the eater of it, the digestion. All these are mere modification of Brahman, just as the waves are of the sea. The one established in Brahmavastha is this wise, in this wise attains Brahman. So the one who's doing everything as an act of, or sees Brahman in every action, whether it is eating, cooking, cleaning, then that is the one who's who, I guess it is in a way, it helps with the Karma Yoga in that you're not getting attached to anything. You're not attached to the act of cooking. You're not attached to the act of eating. You're not attached to the pleasures that come from having something good. I mean, it's easy to detach ourselves from something that is unpleasant, right? But when something is pleasurable, and detaching ourselves is where the real trouble is. And in that sense, that's the reason why I guess it talks about the finer aspects, nicer aspects of all of the food or waves and things like that.
So, you know, one thing that they talk, another example is that I see. Light is the energy of fire. It can be considered as different from the fire because it exists outside it, but it can also be reckoned as part of the fire itself. Hence, when the rays of the sun enter a room through a window, people say sun has come, but it's actually bundling of sun rays with the sun that enters. The energy is both distinct from the energetic and yet a part of it. So like how sun rays make you feel, you know, but it is also part of the sun. That's how, similar like the ocean waves, that example that you gave, that's how we should perceive everything or a disturbance in the divine consciousness that we are able to feel and see. Anything else? That is the jnanam, jnana yognya, that is the divine knowledge. It may not be very easy to grasp it. It might be abstract. So that's why there are other ways of getting to the stage. Am I right? Any comments on that?
Yeah, that's fine. I just wanted to understand the meaning literally here. Maybe Srinivasa Kreti can clarify that. What's the difference between Havis and Hutam? Hutam is the ghee, I think. Havis?
Havish, I mean, I think, you know, whatever I know, like, you know, Huta means, you know, like offering into the fire. That is ghee or anything. Havish, yes. So, Havish is also the that's made with rice and with the other beef is made. Havish is generally, But what you said here is, you know, it's abstract meaning you have to take, not literally. Yes. It means,
absolutely.
Yeah, what you said is correct, actually. Every action that we are doing, like, you know, as an yajna, that itself. Okay, when you are doing any action, if you are doing it as in a Brahma position, that means you become the Brahma, and the instrument that we are doing, that are also Brahma, and the action, it becomes Brahma, and whatever is coming out of, since it is all doing this way, coming phalam is also Brahma Samadhi. The Brahma Samadhi is like, you know, the Paramapta Prapti, that's also coming out of that one. It is part of, I think it's a Karma Sannyasa Yoga. It starts from where you are not the, you don't have the Kartrutvam, that, you know, doership is not there. When we see that is the final difference between Karma Yoga and Karma Sannyasa Yoga. When the Karma Yoga, still doer has the some doership, you know, like I am doing for this reason, I am doing for the God, I am doing this, I think that is there. As we are losing that doership, then I am not doing it. When doing it, then Prakriti is making me do it. I am, you know, the Lord is making me to do it. And, you know, Paramatma, whatever, you know, like, you know, whatever happening is because of him, then we are losing the doership. Then it becomes Karma Sannyasa Yoga. That's where it starts, the Jnanam. Jnanam means, you know, like the Jnana Yoga also. That's what people say here. What you said is, you know, every act is a yajnam. And when you are doing the yajna, you are doing for the Loka Kalyanartham, not for yourself, not for self gaining anything. And when you are doing with this kind of thought, whoever is doing the yajna is Brahma, and instruments are Brahman, and Agni is the Pavitram, where the is offered is Brahman. And when you see everything as a Brahman, the outcome is also Brahma Prapti. That's what I think, that's my understanding.
Yeah. So just a question. So is this shloka also building, in a way, tyag, like?
Anybody wants to answer?
That's is it building tyaga phalatyagam?
Tyaga buddhi. I mean, is it telling that everything is basically tyag? Whatever you do. Or no?
It's an offering to God is what they are saying. Any act, everything, you know, all thought process is also an act offering to God.
Yeah.
I guess that is what Srinivas was saying, right?
See,
the doership.
See, the tyaga is, you know, like slightly, I think it is slightly different, because when you're sacrificing, that means you have some ownership at one point. You think that, you know, you have some ownership and you're sacrificing, renouncing that one. But here, there is no basis for that doership. When you're doing, you're not doing, there is no renunciation also. Right. Yeah. That's what my understanding.
Yeah,
so Abhay, one good example, Swami Chinmayananda says, you know, if you are very, very much towards the sattvic mindset, just the jnana yoga will get you to the Paramatma. But if you are still, you know, in the more learning process, you have karma, you know, you have to do the, you have to be in that space. Mm-hmm. Then you offer that from the doership, you renunciate the doership, like Srinivas was saying. You get into this state. From this state, you get the direct knowledge.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
And I think in the next few slokas, we'll talk about that. That's why I've sequenced these that way. Mm-hmm. And this is again talking about the divine knowledge. This is Jnana Yoga. One more sloka from chapter 4, 39. What a person. There are three qualities that are given here that I wanted to discuss. Who wants to go?
I'll go. Shraddhavan labhate jnanam tatpara sanyama indriyaha jnanam labhva param shanti itirena adigacchati. Jnan is Shraddha. Devoted master of one's senses attains this knowledge. Having attained knowledge, one goes at once to the supreme peace. That's all.
Thank you, Shyamji. There is some noise, but yeah, I don't know where it is coming from. But I'll give my short commentary and then we will open. Shraddha means faith. Faith in God, in absolute truth, is what faith in oneself is a focus. There are three qualities that is being talked about here, which is needed. Faith, which is Shraddha. Tatpara, which is devotion. You know, devotion to whatever you are doing towards the higher goal. And self-control. Here, Indriya, you know, controlling your Indriyas. Sanyata Indriya, that part. So those three qualities are needed to achieve liberation, to realize our true nature, overcoming our ignorance and transcending our limited selves, and reach the divine. That's the divine knowledge. That's the path of the divine knowledge that is being emphasized here. Please go ahead. If there are any other comments that you want to add?
So since this is about...
Yeah. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
You want to say about what Ramakrishna Sharma wants to say about? Read it for me.
Go ahead.
You can say. I think you have the same book that I have.
Yes.
Please go ahead.
Okay. Ramakrishna Sharma says, "When will I have the vision of God?" Asked an ardent disciple of the master. Instead of giving a direct answer, he took the novice to the seashore and held him immersed in water for a while. He was then asked how he felt. Said, "I thought I would die for want of air to breathe," came the answer. Such a quest of God would reveal him immediately, was the answer given by the master. So profound. This is by Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa.
Beautiful, Veena ji.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Any other comments? So the ultimate spiritual aim of any jnani is to realize or attain practical and experienced knowledge of this, of Brahma, right? And what are all needed is something that you need faith. Faith has to be deep. You need to practice controlling your mind and senses.
Is that faith translate exactly to sincerity? I'm just thinking out loud. So because typically seeing faith in jnana yoga is a little bit paradoxical.
I think it's the shraddha, the word
shraddha. Sincerity, yeah. Because you don't need to believe in anything in jnana yoga, right? But you need to have the sincerity to understand the higher. So,
yeah, but you need to believe in the existence of the absolute truth. Believe in that absolute truth. That is the faith in terms of, if you think about belief, belief in the universal consciousness, the absolute truth that pervades, and being sincere to that belief.
Mm-hmm.
You know, belief may change anytime, but unquestioned, you know, unquestioned, mm-hmm. unruffled belief, I call, is one step ahead, and it is called faith, right?
Yeah. It's slightly different in the sense we use this word in Bhakti Yoga. This is not the same kind of faith for a particular Saguna Brahma or something like that.
Not to a form.
Yeah.
Anything else to add?
Can somebody add like
the word tatparaha here is really devoted. Oh. That means you are believing in something. You know, you are believing in some Saguna Brahma or Nirguna Brahma, but you are devoted to your faith, your belief. So,
yeah, you're right.
First
means supreme.
But again, Shyamji, you know, in this particular chapter, like devotion to the path that you have taken, right? Devoted to your faith, that you are a strong conviction. You don't turn back. You don't change your mind. Okay, now Krishna is not giving me what I want. You know, I'll go and worship another god. Not that type of form, Saguna devotion, right? It is devotion to the ultimate knowledge. You want to reach the ultimate. Is that right, Shyam?
Yes, I mean, whatever your path you have taken, the faith or the devotion that path is the aspect I think this particular shloka says. So the first thing is that the devotion has to be there, and second thing is intensity has to be there to be able to get the jnana, and from getting the parajnana, then you can get the peace that is sort of the essential supreme peace.
Okay. Thank you. We can move on to the next sloka. I know we are running behind, but I don't want to make this process fast. We want to discuss. We want to meditate on the meaning. So if you're all available, please continue to stay beyond 10 o'clock. Our next one is chapter 6, verse 6 and 26. You know, all these slokas is something I connected to. So the sequence might be different if anybody else were to choose this. So, this is again, we talked about controlling our mind in the previous sloka, right? But in these set of slokas, it talks about how mind, how we have to stay. Who wants to go first? Okay. If not, I can go with this. उद्धरेत आत्मनात्मानम् नात्मानम् मानयेत् आत्मैव ह्यात्मनो बंधुः आत्मैव रिपुरात्मनः. A man must elevate himself by his own mind, not degrade himself. the mind is the friend of the conditioned soul, and the mind is his enemy as well. This particular sloka, you know, I picked for young kids also. Even though they may not understand Bhagavad Gita, this is very helpful. Everybody has to elevate themselves by their own thinking process, by their own mind. It may be contextually a little different if you look at verses 1, 2, 3. But you know, overall, that is something that energized me. You know, you have the power to elevate yourself from the state you are in. Your teacher, your guru, or, you know, you cannot put a blame on somebody else. It is you who have to take responsibility and go up, you know, go beyond, you know, go improve yourself. And the self-control is also being dealt here. Importance of mind control. Mind is your friend, mind is your enemy. Success in a meditation or any path is not possible unless you control your mind. With that, I'll open up for others to speak.
Some Patanjali Yoga Sutram is there, right? Manayeva Bandha Manayeva Manushyanam Karanam Bandha Mokshayo. So mind is both the reason for the feelings of attachment and also for salvation. So everything is everything is in the mind.
Yep. That is the root cause, you know. Watch your thoughts, where they come from, mind, and how do we always we need to, well, the mind has to always dwell upon the Parabrahman, right? That is the whole goal. If you end, we have to always steer ourselves. So if the mind is not doing that, it can be our enemy also in our progress. Anything else?
I have something. Self-conscious nature of man is here considered in two aspects, as being both the object of spiritual uplift and the subject of spiritual uplift. The ego acted upon and the ego acting upon the former. This latter activity of ego should be kept strong in its uplifting function, for it is apt to turn an enemy if it is not a friend. The next verse explains the reason.
So we can read the next verse, and if there is some connection with the next verse. But yeah, very good point, Shyamji. I guess if I understand right, you're saying you have to use the power of ego to elevate yourself, but then don't get attached that to that ego. Correct? Is that right?
Yeah, I think it says that the self should be a friend of oneself. But to the unconquered self, the self is inimical.
Yes.
And the else, you know, as a foe.
Yeah, yeah. How wonderful. Wonderfully put. Can I go with the next line? 26? Yeah. Okay. Who wants to read that? Yato, yato. Verse 626. Anybody wants to go on? Vasu or Gagan, Ashaji? Anybody? If not, I can go. Abhay. Right?
Yato,
yato. Yato, yato nischarati manaschanchalam astiram tatastato niyam yaitad atmanyeva vasham nayet atmanyeva vasham nayet. Whenever and wherever the restless and unsteady mind wanders, one should bring it back and continuously focus it on God. I guess this is what anytime we sit to do meditation or anything, we always, our mind wanders and it goes in different directions. And that is something Krishna points out. You know, it's going to be very difficult. Jnana Yoga is the most difficult of all. You would need, you need some self-control to always bring back the focus back to God. And whenever, wherever the restless, there are several slokas. One example I really like is where they talk about mind to a turtle, just like how turtle withdraws its limbs, like that your mind has to withdraw from all the objects or sense objects that will drift you away from the path that you are taking. That was one sloka. I don't know which chapter it comes, but comparison of your mind with that of a turtle or a tortoise that withdraws its limbs, focuses on what is really important. Please go ahead.
I think this is the essential practice taught by Ramana Maharshi, I think, self-inquiry. There he clearly clarifies that bring it back to the source of that thought. So, but this is a basic practice where whenever the thoughts come, you bring it back to the source of the thought, practically. Yeah.
Go ahead, Vidya.
Here, mine says, the vision of the Lord is not possible as long as even an iota of desire is left lingering in the mind. You ought to, therefore, fulfill the innocent and harmless little desires before doing away with them and to mercilessly exterminate the baneful ones with the sword of discrimination. So we heard the story several times in our reading that there was this sannyasi or a very elevated person that everyone revered, and he one day passes away. And so the question is, should he be, his final rite should be done in the as a sannyasi because he has not taken sannyasa as such, or should he be treated like a normal person? So one other sannyasi says, okay, let's look at all his possessions and what he has done. So they find that in his robe, he had tied a small piece of kalkand, you know, the sugar candy or something sweet he has in there to be eaten later. So the very fact that he was attached to that little piece of candy to have later, that means it showed some attachment that he had. He wasn't fully renounced, and therefore he was not to be treated as a sannyasi. Mm. So imagine that. I mean, if there is a little attachment to something that physical, then if that alone keeps you away from getting the jnana, then all of us are have a long
way to go. We'll get depressed.
We have a long way to go, that's all.
Solid example,
You know, like the power of this, you know, like, you know, the Chinmayananda gives an example. You know, whenever you sit in meditation, you start drifting. Just stop. The first instant, you start drifting. You know, at the early stages, is what I think. That's what you're saying, Vidya. Like, just in the bud, bring it back. Bring it back.
Yeah, nip it in the bud. But I mean, obviously, it's a lot easier said than done. So many times you sit for meditation and then mind is like it has traveled the whole world.
Yeah. I guess your next sloka is going to tell us, you know, if you're not able to do that easily, what might be the next step? Any other comments? So I think I want to bring this distinction. The previous one is Dhyana Yoga. Here you can say it is an abhyasa yoga, yoga abhyasam, right? Where you are trying to have practice, you're practicing through meditation or whatever, and trying to go into the stage of jnana yoga, or where you are trying to visualize that you are part of the divine. Anas Chanchalam, how to do that using your abhyasam in a rigorous practice.
Also,
what is the next step?
Krishna says in another place that only way you make it stable, sthira, is, you know, through abhyasena to kaunteya. So that is, so this is only through abhyasa, through practice, this, you know, this can be achieved. So abhyasa is very important. That's in a sense, this question.
Right.
Yep, 100%. If I'm not even able to drift my mind, okay, what can we do now? So, path of devotion, bhakti yoga, sloka. I have, who want to chant this? Chapter number 12, verse number 9. Whenever you're ready, chapter number 12, verse number 9.
If no one is going, then I can go.
Go ahead.
Ath chittam samadhatum nashaknoshi mayi sthiram abhyasa yogena tato mamichhatum dhananjaya. If you are not able to fix your mind steadily on me, O Dhananjaya, then seek to reach me by Abhyasa Yoga.
I'll read my translation here. If you are unable to fix your mind steadily on me, O Arjuna, then practice remembering me with devotion while constantly restraining the mind from worldly affairs. That was the translation that I picked from Chinmayananda's book. I guess Abhyasa Yoga through devotion, where when you not able to control your mind, if you love something, maybe if you love the form of Krishna, or if you love the form of Hanuman, or you love the form of Mahalakshmi or Saraswati or any Devi, maybe with that devotion that comes with some love towards that Saguna form, it will be easier for you to drift your mind from all these unnecessary things. So that is the other method that they are prescribing. If you are not able to do that, how about with devotion, with bhakti yoga, do your abhyasam of bringing back your mind towards God. That is the comment. Anything to add on that? Did that make sense?
Go ahead.
No, that's fine. I was just asking, like, what are the different ways we can devote ourselves? Is it like means chanting, meditation? Like, what are all different ways? Anybody practicing?
I guess, chanting the names and thinking bhajan, kirtan, you know, bhajanam, kirtanam, you know, all those are very powerful, you know, to make your mind music. Connects you to God. If that is what is the best way, you do bhajan and kirtanam and chanting the name of God. So I guess those are some of the things.
Yeah, chanting is absolutely important. Namasmaran. Along with that, while working also, if you can do certain level of that, then that is also good actually. I try to do it, not always happens, but while working also, in the beginning of course of work, but while during work also. And just to add actually, this sloka 9 is absolutely important as we are taking that. But just I think we need to refer 8th sloka also. And this 9th sloka is a derivation coming from that. In 8th sloka, Krishna is telling that, you push or fix your mind on me and put your buddhi on me. So there is a difference though. He's telling to fix, meaning literally put a nail and push it onto me. Like mind has to be nailed onto me. Buddhi, yes, you can bring. And then in this sloka, he's saying, okay, if that is not possible, then you do abhyasa. Right. So in one sentence, it is told there that nail your mind on me, put your buddhi on me, and then only, then obviously without any samshaya, you will come to me. You and me will be together. And if that is not possible, then do this abhyasa. Yeah, thank you.
Abhyasa is like a physical thing. Probably if your mind is not able to be focused, then at least do it physically by chanting the names or reading about the God and that physical things. Eventually, that will take you to the mental level.
Yeah.
I just paraphrase Swami Sri Ramakrishna's little story here. So he talks about a man who owns this dog. So a very affectionate dog. So one day a visitor comes and the dog jumps on the master's lap and starts licking him like dogs do. And so the visitor says, this is not good. So the man says, okay, I have to train my dog to not lick me. So every time the dog licks him, he, you know, punishes the dog somehow. The dog very quickly learns that, okay, my master doesn't like my licking him. Therefore, he stops licking. So he says, you should train your mind like that. Every time there is something that is wavering you, you should kind of come back to remind yourself that, no, your goal is to be meditation or thinking about jnana and not about other things.
Beautiful examples. Sri Ramakrishna puts like very simple.
Simple words, and everybody can relate to those experiences.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. If not, we can go to the next one. Chapter 12, same chapter, 12th verse number 12, where there is a connection between abhyasam, and jnanabhyasam, dhyana, and Atyagam. This wants to go here?
So I will try. This is not, I don't chant all the Bhagavad Gita all the time. So Sreyohi Jnanam Abhyasat Jnanat Dhyanam Visishyate Dhyanat Karma Phalatyaga Tyagat Chantir Anantaram. So better than mechanical practice is knowledge. Better than knowledge is meditation. So better than meditation is renunciation of the fruits of action. So that will immediately, the peace will immediately follow such renunciation. Yeah, it's a sequence, very natural, right? We can easily envision this. So he's giving a sequential, what is superior. So instead of mechanically doing things, having the knowledge why we are doing that is important, and better than knowledge, if you will be able to meditate, that's higher level. And even you don't need to meditate if you are really able to renunciate, just leave the karma phalatyaga. That will instantly give you the eternal peace. It makes sense, right? We become agitated because of we don't get what we expect out of what we do. So.
You know, thanks, Srinivas. That's a very good way to put it. You know, in Chinmayananda gives an explanation. He goes the opposite direction. You know, he says the quietness of mind, says, right? It talks about the last word. Tyaga chantir anantaram immediately follows the quietness of peace. If you are ruffled, if you are not, again, whatever I mentioned before, depending upon your vasanas, you may not be able to do dhyanam, or you may not have jnanam. So start from karma phala tyagam first. Whatever you do, just, you know, do the karma phala tyagam. That will automatically puts your mind in a peace, in a quiet status. At that point of time, you will be able to meditate better. At that, when you meditate better, you will get the jnanam. When you get the jnanam, whatever practice you do, whatever rituals you do, they become more meaningful. Did that make sense? Like, you start with your karma phala tyagam is something, if you are really not able to, you are in starting, as a starting process, start with karma phala tyagam. That itself will give you peace of mind. That will help you meditate better. That meditation will give you the knowledge, divine knowledge, the jnanam. That will give meaning to all the rituals, whatever you're doing. It would, that mechanical practice is no longer mechanical. They become meaningful.
that is Buddha's way, right? Instantly renunciating the action. That is extremely difficult. I think it's very difficult to do that. So probably this makes a more practical sense.
Yeah. Because you know, controlling the mind through meditation is actually more difficult than, if it gets difficult, then to go operate in the mode, you're always action. Do all action without any expectation and do the Falatyagam. It will bring you to the other stages more quickly. I don't know. Please comment on it. This is interpretation from Chinmayananda's book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's always not very clear whether knowledge, better knowledge leads to meditation or meditation leads to better knowledge. It's not clear to me. For many others, it may be very clear, but...
Yeah, that is what Chinmayananda takes it, that is the question he answers, which is better. Not that karma phala tyagam is better, karma phala tyagam is told here better because it gives you the peace of mind immediately and that leads to other things to be achieved much easier. Because if you are in a good state of meditation or if you have the jnanam, you'll already be doing karma phala tyagam. Anyone else, you wanted to say something?
Actually, and I don't know, but it is not just what is better, what is, like if you see the context is, you have to read 8, 9, 10, 11 all together actually in this also. Because mm-hmm. The Lord is saying the first one we studied 8, right? He said, mm-hmm. Fix buddhi, manas on me. If mm-hmm. cannot do that one, you do the abhyasa yoga. Okay, mm-hmm. You do the practicing abhyasa. We already talked what is the abhyasa, living as principle life is also an abhyasa and chanting. So many things you have to put your body and mind to the work actually, that abhyasa. But a lot of people cannot run that principle life. If that cannot be done, then he's saying that, you do the karmas for me. Okay, you do the karmas for me. That was he saying in the 10th one. But doing the karmas for Lord is also difficult for many people because, whenever we do the karma, our karma is tainted with the desires. That's why we may start with, I want to do it for the God. But, as we go, our desires won't let us do the karmas for Lord himself. Then he says, if you cannot do that one, do the karma phala tyaga. That means, you do some, it's tainted with, desires. But at the end of the day, you offer everything to me. That's what he's saying, that is the sequence he's saying. Then he says, from abhyasat jnanam sreyaha. That means from this practice of, the principled life, the jnanam is better. Jnanam means not the jnanam that we are talking about, the true, what is jnanam? The true nature, understanding the true nature of a thing is jnanam, okay? But just what we are trying to understand here, we are getting confused with what is jnanam. Jnanam means the information is not jnanam. For example, we have the information that, okay, Lord is in everywhere. I see God, Lord is then you, me, and all the sarva bhuti, all the living things. God is manifested things, he is everywhere. But that is information, that is not jnanam. Jnanam is that having that practical experience that, seeing that in reality, that is jnanam. Mm-hmm. But here what he's saying is jnanam is means that is the shastra jnanam, just, that information type of knowledge is better than abhyasa. But that information knowledge, that kind of informative knowledge is not the true knowledge. That is better, jnanam is better than this one. But here jnanam is not talking about that nirvikalpa, vikalpa samadhi. He is talking about that whatever you thought, whatever you learned, that information, thinking about that information, not realizing the God. But again, you are thinking and you are attaching that yourself with some desires. That's why that is jnanam is better than at least jnanam. Okay? At least you are meditating upon, you are thinking about that one, but still it's tainted, okay, with the desires. From dhyanam, karma phala tyagam is better. When from that kind of dhyanam, the karma phala, renouncing all the fruits of the thoughts, actions, everything, whatever you do, sarva karma phala tyagam, not just any there. Sarva is saying everything from mind, buddhi, speech, everything, whatever you do, offer it to the Lord. That is better than all these practices. And that's what it gives the shanti, because when you offer everything, you don't keep anything yourself, you don't have interest in everything, you have that samabuddhi, everything that comes along with that karma, sarva karma phala tyagam. When you have that status, you will get the param shanti. That means an absolute, the supreme peace, you know, that's what from this tyagam. That's what I understand. I don't know whether it's you can say.
Yeah, makes sense.
That's absolutely
all the
true.
Anxiety, all the thing, attachment, you know, goes away when you do the karma for the tyaga, brings up the peace, right?
The problem comes with the translation of jnana to knowledge.
Yes,
as
yes.
You clarified it, that should be information.
True.
That's why explanation is more important than just to translation.
Yeah. There's a nice little story here about renunciation and practicing. So a few dogs, they find some bread that is thrown around and they are fighting over it. So there is absolutely no peace in this situation. Nobody gets anything. They are all fighting and, you know, a lot of chaos. But then on the other hand, the crow, one crow finds a pile of rice. It calls all the other birds to come and share the food. So the crow in that sense is much more knowledgeable because it is practicing peace naturally. There is no fighting among all the birds. They are just eating whatever they find and they're sharing with everybody. So that is a nice way. It's the abhyasa part, it's the renunciation part, it's not keeping it for itself. And then another little portion is another bird finds a piece of meat and then it goes, takes it to the tree and sits down to eat that. And then all the other bunch of birds come and they're fighting. They're not letting the bird eat the meat. So the bird keeps on flying from tree to tree, trying to find a peaceful place where it can eat. It's unable to. So finally it says, okay, this meat is causing me so much problem. So it throws away the meat and then sitting happily in one place. So that is the renunciation that we need to practice. So when we get attached to things, it's causing a lot of unnecessary jealousy and fights and all of those things that is happening. And once we let go of the thing that we are attached to, and that is also abhyasa, right? You slowly let go of little things. Obviously, we are not attached to the little toys or outfits or other things that we were attached to when we were little kids.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure as we get older, we may not be attached to the jewelry and makeup and this and that, whatever that we are attached to right now. So slowly, it's a process of those are some things that we can do, we experience ourselves at this time. But similarly with family, friends, everything, not to get too hung up on anything.
Very good point.
That's in Avadhutopakhyanam, right, Vijay? I think the story, the bird story you mentioned, I think one of the 21 gurus, he mentions that bird, which got bothered by all other birds and just leaves a piece of meat.
This is
peaceful.
I didn't know about that part. This one is again Sri Ramakrishna.
Okay.
Explanation.
I remember reading this particular example as a story in Avadhutopakhyanam.
You know, the other thing, that point that he brings about is the thought process. A lot of people do rituals mechanically. They do a puja, or some puja goes on, everybody's in the temple. They attend the puja, but they talk to each other. It becomes an empty ritual. And those type of mechanical empty rituals, you know, are the lowest in all. And that is mechanical practice, that word that is being said there. Refers to that, where a lot of people do rituals just for the sake of it and it becomes empty quickly if your mind is not into it.
Yeah.
I wanted to bring that point.
I would like to just add Paramarthananda, Swami Paramarthananda's definition, just quickly about abhyasa, jnanam, and dhyanam. And please do not take this as absolute, but this is how he says. Knowledgeless meditation is abhyasa. Okay? Then meditationless knowledge is jnanam. And knowledge with meditation, or meditation with knowledge with meditation, or meditation with knowledge is dhyanam. That's it. Let's talk. You all talk.
That is very well put.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Thank you, Abhay. This is from whom, Abhay?
This is Swami Paramarthananda.
There are no comments. We can move to the next one. Couple more slokas. Chapter 9, verse 6. Anybody wants to go? If nobody wants, I can do it. Yatha kashastito nityam ayuhu sarvatra gomahan tata sarvani bhu Tani Matanityupadaraya Daraya. So know that as the mighty wind blowing everywhere rests always in the sky, likewise all living beings rest always in me. Know that as the mighty wind blowing everywhere rests always in the sky, likewise all living beings rest always in me. I wanted to bring these examples. Very beautiful examples are spread all over. One of them is this one, where like how the wind that feed and is always in the sky, rests always in the sky. Likewise, always all living me. You could take it when it is said as rests in me. It's just Bhagwan who upholds everything. It is him who lifts everything up. So all living things that we see, everything that we see is part of him. Or you can even see when they say rests in me, it means it is him, his consciousness that upholds everything. We are all part of it. We are one in it. And how Srinivas says, you have to read the previous slokas. And for all these slokas, this is just a seed. You can read again. Go to the previous three slokas, the following slokas, and connect them. It talks about how the souls have no existence independent of God. They may move in time, place, consciousness through every body, but they always exist within the God. If you see in the cosmos, it's subordinate to the will of God. It is created, maintained, and annihilated according to his will. In that way also, everything can be said to be resting in him. Anything else that you want to add on this sloka? This is again a deep verse. There is another example where ocean and the waves on it are given example, where ocean is the universal consciousness. We are the disturbances show up as the material manifestations like humans, beings or other living things or anything, any material nature. Those are all the disturbances that you see, but it is part of the ocean.
Yeah.
It's a practical reason why the flights go 10,000 feet high. So there is no agitation. In general, I think the higher you go up, your vision will be broader and then you will be easily able to discriminate. Okay. So,
but here again, you are saying the entire sky is God.
Yeah, yeah.
The wind is part of the sky. It's you know, it's rests in it. It is not separate. Anything else to add?
Ramakrishna Paramahamsa again, you know, he says,
Though
the wind carries the good and bad order, alike it remains unaffected by both. Parabrahman is in this wise unaffected by the phenomenal universal.
Wow.
That's nice.
Very good.
It's very profound.
Yes.
So,
it also touches upon the Dvaita Advaita Bhavam, right? Yes. You know, there is no separate existence. The wind has no existence independent of the sky. So that is not, you know, it's an Advaita philosophy. Srinivas, you want to say something?
This is, I know what Aziz pointed out, you know, like how the Sarva Bhutan, Sarva universe and everything, all the living things exist in the God. That's what he is giving example, right? Here, the comparison is the Akasham is Paramatma, as you all know. Akasham is Avyaktam here. Avyaktam means, you know, it's not manifested to the, you know, like we cannot see with eyes. Okay. Similarly, God is Avyaktam, right? We cannot see perceived. Mm-hmm. But again, within the Akasha, Vayu, you know, exists and it moves and it, you know, like it, but it is, Akasha is not attached to the Vayu. Okay, they're, you know, it's not, and the existence of Vayu is not affecting the Purnatvam of Akasha. It's not, you know, Purnatvam, right? It's a completeness, wholeness. I don't know how do you exactly say that one. Okay, similarly, Akasha is the Adharam, you know, like, you know, what you came support for the Vayu, right? Similarly, the Lord Paramatma is all pervading Paramatma, that is what supporting to the all the living things. They exist within himself, but it's not affected by him. Their movements, you know, like you know, wind moves with different speeds, different way, it gets heat, cold, everything, but it's not affecting the Paramatma. It's actually separation. It's not affecting at all. It's not affecting the Paramatma at all. That's what. And whatever the causing, the cause of the you know, wind movements and everything, is Akasham is not making it happen. Similarly, Bhagavan is not karta for the whole things in this universe. We are the karta. At least, you know, the gunas are kartas. Gunartha are doing, you know, like all the things. But Bhagavan is not the karta here. That's what the separation you have to. I think, you know, that is the way.
Okay. That is a key point you are saying, because the next sloka says, I don't rest in them, right? He says, I think next sloka is, everything rests in me, I don't rest in them. That, you know, can confuse people. And for that is what you are saying. When you say that the meaning of that rest in them means that gunas are independently acting, taking things,
yes.
Souls move from one place to the other, from one body to the other, do all these actions.
Yeah.
That means when he says, they rest in me, but I don't rest in them. Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah, that's correct. Because they're not, see, God is not limited to the living things. You know, he is there in everywhere, but he's not limited to that particular thing. Or, you know, like I'm, you know, that's why he's saying I'm there, but I'm not there. But, you know, similarly, here his presence is everywhere. Because everything is living here, but it's not identified with that particular thing at any moment. Because it doesn't have any stability. It doesn't have any existence, true existence itself.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Because of that thought only, I picked the next sloka. You know, I want to see what, if there are no other comments, you know, there are also slokas, verses where it says, I am in everyone's heart, right? I am in everyone's, I'm situated in everybody's heart. That is the sloka I have next. But then this Advaita, Dvaita, still not Dvaita. What you are saying is not, still not Dvaita, right, Srinivas?
It is at this moment, it's Dvaitam only, because Prakriti is, even though Prakriti is different, Prakriti is here, is both are different, they are not connected here. Even though one exists within himself, is probably, I would say, Visishta Advaita, maybe, you know, like it's part of the Lord, but it has its own identity at this moment. Probably Visishta Advaita, I would say. I don't know, but it leads to that kind of argument.
Yeah. But what makes really sense is how God doesn't interfere with the gunas behavior and what they how they act, that you cannot blame God for it. It is that, you know, karma.
And most important, you have to remember that, you know, Vayu, it is born from Akasha. You know, Panchabhutas, how everybody knows, right? Akashad, Vayu, Vayu, Ragni, Agni, Rapa, Adhya, Prithvi, like this, there's a sequence, right? And when they in the pralayam, it goes back in the, it rolls back in the similar way. That means Akasha, this Vayu is coming from, is born from Akasha and is going back into the Akasha when it is in the end. Similarly, all the Prakriti, the Sarva Bhutani, all the living things are the manifesting everything. It is coming from Bhagavan and going into the Bhagavan again. You have to see that also.
Okay. All right. We could. All right. Any other comments on this?
Good. Nice.
So next sloka, which is the final sloka. Chapter number 15, verse number 15. There are so many slokas, but I just in my thinking process, I connected all of them. That's why I put it. If we were to, somebody else had to do it, they would pick totally different slokas. One thing is, we are all discussing when several minds get together. Multiplied, right? Chapter 15, verse 15. Are you able to see my screen?
Yeah.
Who wants to go?
Sarvasya chaham buddhi sannivishto matta smriti jnanam apohanam cha vedaishta sarvairahameva vetyo vedanta kritveda videha chaham. And I am seated in the hearts of all. From me are memory, knowledge, as well as their loss. I am verily that which has to be known by all the Vedas. I am indeed the author of the Vedanta, as well as the knower of the Vedas. That's the translation.
Thank you, Veenaji. That was good. I have similar sentence. I am seated in the hearts of all living beings, and from me come memory, knowledge, as well as forgetfulness. I am to be known by all the Vedas. I am the author of the Vedanta and the knower of the meaning of the Vedas. So please start discussion on it. This is another sloka I picked it when we do this in our youth club. We use this sloka to talk about forgiveness. Anybody whom you don't disagree with, remember that they also have God situated in them. You know, whatever, everybody, every human being, there is God. There is forgiveness automatically comes when you have that thought process. Again, this is very for people who are in initial levels of development, because there is nothing for one person to forgive other. But in case there is hatred, learning the sloka will help them see the goodness in everyone as well. It's something I liked from this sloka.
This sloka gives a central message of Bhagavad Gita.
Uh-huh.
That is, God is everything, and everything is God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Agree, Shyamji.
It also puts chapter 11 and 10, everything in here. So he's saying that I am there in everything that is beautiful. I'm the knowledge. I am this. So all of chapter 10 is put in this one line. And then the second line of this explains. Yeah, both the Vibhuti Yoga and what's the other one, number 11? Vishwarupa Darshanam. So it kind of puts everything in that entire two chapters. I feel like it is in this verse.
Yeah.
But it's interesting too that he included forgetfulness also, because in Vibhuti Yoga he was emphasizing that what everybody considers as great is his amsha.
Mm-hmm.
But here he is saying, even if it is not great, that is also coming from me. Remember that. So don't look down upon anything.
Right.
Yes.
So this is something, Srinivas, again, I want to ask. Now here, isn't this a conflict of thought from the previous sloka? No? Where here we are saying, he is everything, he's situated in everyone. But, you know, in the other one, where he also... is I am not in them, right? That difference, Bhava, is should we not take it that way?
It's you know, he's there in everywhere, but he's that's what, you know, like the difference between, you know, is not limited to the particular living thing. That's what his vibhuti is, much more bigger than that one, but he's there in that, in everyone. He's giving all the you know, characteristics or whatever, you know, like as he said, you know, forget jnanam is you know, memory and everything according to karma phalas. He is there as a karma phala data. He is there in everyone, and that's what I think. And it's not the previous sloka says, "I am there, but I am not there." That's what he says. But he is there as a universal consciousness, as a karma phala data, and he is not confined to that particular living thing. That's why he is not there in that way. That's what I understand.
Okay, sounds good. Everything that we see, living or non-living, that is, it is being enlivened by Paramatma, by the universal consciousness that enlivens every matter, everything that we see and feel. The thing that enlivens them is Paramatma, which is the universal consciousness. Okay. Any other comments? I want to talk about Aham Brahmasmi, some of these Brahma Sutras, the Mahavakyas. You know, once you reach the stage, that's when you reach the connection of yourself with everything around yourself, which is the universal consciousness, the higher, greater spirit, absolute truth. And this is it's through several paths that we have discussed here. We can get, it's up to us to take it. Gita has given us it's a very good compilation of everything, Veda, Vedanta, Upanishads. Lot of important thoughts have been compiled and summarized here. Again, like Gita, we have several thousands of very popular scriptures. It's like an endless collection of scriptures that we have in our Sanatana Dharma. And I guess we... let's please read through, at least if in our lifetime, if we could read one or two, that will be a great achievement. And if we stand by it, any other questions, comments?
Just want to make one comment.
Yes.
And just going back to that twin shlokas that Srinivas Sagrede and Vijay was talking in the beginning. There was a sequence, right? How the anger leads to that and all those things. And it starts with Dhyayato Vishayan Pumsaha. So, attachment. And I think the solution, I remember, is in one of those Bhajagovinda shlokas, right? Satsangatve Nisangatvam, Nisangatve Nirmohatvam. So, the solution for everything is the Satsangatvam. So, if you can alone meditate and everything, that's fine. But if you cannot do that, at least be in the company like this last 1.5 hour we are having, this is a satsanga. So at least that will lead you to that ultimate peace.
100% agree. We have, that is the, we meet for Lalita Sahasranamam Parayanam every week. One of the benefits is we always tune ourselves on a weekly basis, think about God. Same way, Srinivas, Gagan and I, we meet for Bhagavad Gita discussion. And the satsang makes a big difference. It resets your mind any time you attend that session. And it reminds you constant that satsang is going to lead to nissangatvam. Nissangatvam will lead to nirmohatvam. Nirmohatve, nirmala tattvam. It gives to nirmala tattvam. Nirmala tattve, nishkala tattvam. I think I forget the last few words.
Nishkala tattve, jivan mukti.
Jivan mukti. Yeah. So, jivan mukti. So, it's very, it all starts with a group of people meeting once in a while. Please join these discussions. We did a great, thanks to all of you participating today.
Thank you so much, Deepak. It was really very
thank
nice.
You. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks.
Very nice.
Thank you. Happy Ekadasi and a happy Geeta Jayanti to all.
Yeah.
Yes.
Bye. Yeah, you are muted. Thank you, Shyamji. And,
thank you.
If anyone is interested, we meet on Wednesdays for, meet on Zoom for Bhagavad Gita. So if anyone would like to join, just let me.